Dear students, in this presentation we will be seeing about page replacement in the virtual memory management chapter. In our earlier discussions of the page fault rate, we assumed that each page faults at most once when it is first referenced. Okay, so each page will faults at most only once when it was first referenced. So when we try to access it for the second time, it will be ready in the main memory. Okay, so this representation is not strictly accurate. If a process of 10 pages actually uses only half of them, that is only 5 pages, then demand paging will save the I/O necessary to load the 5 pages that are never used. So we could increase the degree of multiprogramming with the help of page fault, that is by running twice the processes of these numbers. Okay, so thus if we had 40 frames, we can run 8 processes rather than 4 processes that could run if each required 10 frames, among which 5 are never used. That means if I have 40 frames and I have 4 processes, each requires 10 pages, but among 10 pages only 5 were used. In that case, what I can do, instead of running 4 process with 10 pages, I can run 8 processes with only 5 pages. That is how I could increase the multiprogramming, rate of multiprogramming. But if we increase the degree of multiprogramming, we are over allocating the memory. That is, consider an example. If I run 6 process, each of which requires 10 pages in size, but actually uses only 5 pages. Okay, so in that case, again we have higher CPU utilization and throughput. That means again, if I have same 40 frames, instead of running 4 processes with 10 pages, I can run 6 processes with 10 pages, but among 10 pages only 5 were utilized. Okay, only 5 were used, 5 will remain unused. Okay, so I will think that only 5 will be used and I will allocate all the 6 processes to the CPU. Okay, so in such cases, it may so happen that each of these processes for a particular data set may suddenly try to use all of its 10 pages. So in that case, what will happen, resulting in a need for 60 frames when only 40 frames are available. So if they try to use all 10 pages, then we have only 40 frames, but it is requiring 60 frames. Okay, so that is indicating over allocation of memory. Next, if I consider the system memory, it is not only used for holding the program pages, that is, it is not just used for user programs for execution, it is also used for I/O, which is going to consume a significant amount of memory. Okay, so this can increase the strain on the memory placement algorithm, since we have to allocate some memory for user process as well as we have to allocate some memory for I/O buffers. Okay, so we have to decide how much should be allocated to I/O and how much should be allocated to program pages. Okay, so deciding how much memory to allocate to I/O and how much to program pages is a significant challenge. This becomes the significant challenge here. Okay, so we have some systems which will allocate a fixed percentage of memory for I/O buffers as well as for user programs. We have some types of systems wherein both user processes and the I/O subsystem should compete for all of the system memory. So they have to compete for the system memory, and then the memory will be allocated or memory will be divided for two of the things. Suppose if I over allocate memory, what may happen is while a user process is executing, I have over allocated the memory, and in that user process execution is going on, and it leads to a page fault. When this can happen is, I have 43 frames, and instead of running 4 programs with 10 pages, what I am doing, I am running 4 programs or 4 processes with 10 pages, assuming that all of them will use only 5 of those pages. instead of 10, I assume that they will use 5 of them. But if they try to use all 10 or more than 5, it may so happen that a page fault may occur. So then what the operating system will do? The operating system determines where the desired page is residing on the disk. Okay, so now when a page fault occurs, what the operating system should do? Operating system should find the page in the disk and bring it back to the main memory. Okay, so what it will do? It will determine where the desired page is residing on the disk, but then it should also find for a free frame in the main memory. But suppose if there are no free frames in the main memory, then what will happen is a page cannot be loaded, which indicates all of the memory is in use. So we can see this in the figure in the next slide. You can see here we have logical memory for user 1 and logical memory for user 2. We have page table for user 1 and user 2. So this is the physical memory. We have two processes which have used all of the pages that were there on the main memory. Okay, so this physical memory, we can see that there is no free frame here. Okay, in such conditions, the operating system has several options. One is it could terminate the user process. So if it terminates the user process, what will happen is we are using demand paging in the system, which is going to utilize and increase the throughput of the CPU. Okay, and users will not be aware that their processes are running on a paged system. So this paging will be always, it is logically transparent to the user. So this option is not a good choice. The next option is the operating system could swap out a process, freeing all its frames and reducing the level of multiprogramming. It will just swap out a process out of the memory, which is going to free all of its frames, and it will decrease the degree of multiprogramming because we are reducing the number of processes that are executing on the system. Okay, so this option could be a good one in some conditions. So we consider it further. Okay, so that means with this option, what can be the solution is we have one common solution, that is page replacement. Okay, we can see in this figure, for process 1, that is user 1, we have frame 3, 4, 5 which are used and which are valid ones. Frame 3, 4, 5, we can see we have H, load M and J which are all valid. There is one page which is indicated as invalid. So coming to the next one, we have 6, 2, 7 which are all valid pages and there is one kept for invalid. So what I can do, I can swap out a process and then free all of its frames and then allocate these frames to the process that has a page fault. Okay, so this figure, it shows a need for page replacement since we do not have any of the free frames. Okay, so one optimal solution is page replacement for such cases. We have different page replacement algorithms. First, we will see basic page replacement. Okay, so it works as follows. If no frame is free, then we should find one that is not currently being used and free it. Okay, so if there are no free frames, we should find one frame which is not being used currently and we should free it. Okay, so how we can free it is we can write all its contents to swap space and change the page table. So once we are trying to swap it out, we are going to update the page table to indicate that the page is no longer in the memory. Okay, so now we can use this freed frame to hold the page for which the process had page fault. Okay, so now with page replacement, we should modify the routine that has page fault. Okay, so the routine for page fault service will change little, that is with the help of page replacement. So the first step is find the location of the desired page on the disk. Okay, that means for which the page fault has occurred, that page should be found on the disk. And then next, find a free frame. We should search for a free frame. If there is a free frame, then we can use it. Next, if there is no free frame, then we should use a page replacement algorithm to select a victim frame. Okay, if there is a free frame, we can directly use it. If not, we should use one of the page replacement algorithm to select a victim frame. Okay, so next, write the victim frame to the disk, change the page and frame tables accordingly. So okay, victim frame is the one which we are going to replace. Okay, so that page will be returned to the disk, and then we are going to make the changes in the page table and frame table accordingly. Next step is read the desired page into the newly freed frame and again change the page and frame tables. Okay, next is restart the user process. Okay, in this figure you can see the page replacement exactly how it happens. First thing is we need to identify the victim page in the physical memory. Okay, here we have the page table. This is the physical memory in between, and the last one is the disk. Okay, victim page can be identified through the help of any of the page replacement algorithms. And then we need to swap out this victim page to the disk. Okay, next, as and when we swap out a page, we should update the page table. Okay, in the page table we have frame number corresponding to it. We have valid invalid bit. Okay, we should change the bit to I, that is make that particular page as invalid. Okay, next we should swap in the desired page, okay, to the physical memory, and then again we are going to update the page table, and then we can resume the execution of that particular we can notice here is that if no frames are free, then two page transfers, that is one for page in, the other one for page out, are required. Okay, this situation is going to double the page fault service time, as well as it increases the effective access time. Okay, so this is nothing but it is a overhead. Okay, this can be reduced by using a scheme, that is using the modify bit scheme. It is also called as dirty bit. Okay, so each page or frame will be having a modified bit associated with it in the hardware. Okay, so the modify bit for that particular page is set by the hardware whenever any word or any byte of data is written into that particular page. Okay, which indicates that the page has been modified. Any byte or any word means any data, if it is modified, if it is written into, or if it is any modified, then we are going to consider that particular page has been modified. Okay, so whenever we are selecting a page for replacement, we should examine this modify bit. Okay, so if that bit is set, then we will think that the page has been modified since it was read in from the disk. Okay, so in this case, what we have to do, we must write that particular page into the disk, because the data has been modified, and then we should restore that modified page. So that is why we are going to write that page to the disk. Okay, so if there is one more thing, if that bit is not set, okay, that is if modify bit is not set, then we will think that the page has not been modified since it was read into the memory. Okay, if it is modified, it will be in the that means if the page is modified and it will be in the disk, and if it is not, then we will think that it is read into the memory. Okay, so therefore, if the copy of the page on the disk has not been overwritten by some or other page, okay, so then we need not write the memory page into the disk. Okay, it is already there. So whenever there is a modification, then it will be already there in the disk. Okay, so this technique, it also applies to the read only pages. Okay, for example, if there are any pages like containing the binary code, and there also we can apply this technique. Okay, those pages cannot be modified. Okay, so they may be discarded whenever desired, but we cannot modify them. So using this modify bit scheme, what we can do is it will significantly reduce the time required to service a page fault. Okay, and also it reduces the IO time by one half if the page has not been modified. So only when the page is modified, we are going to write it again into the disk. If it is not, then we are not going to do it. So that is how it is going to reduce the time that is required to service a page fault by one half whenever there is a no modification in the page. If it is modified, then it is going to remain same. If the page has not been modified, then the page fault rate will be reduced by half. Page replacement is basic to the demand paging. Here we should solve two major problems to implement demand paging. One is we should develop a frame allocation algorithm, and then we should have a page replacement algorithm. Suppose if we have multiple processes in the memory, then we must decide how many frames to allocate to each of the processes. And then when page replacement is required, we must select the frames that are to be replaced. So frame allocation algorithm, it involves how many frames to be allocated to each of the process. And page replacement algorithm, it will decide which frame to be replaced whenever a page replacement has to be, which frame is to be selected whenever we should replace a page. So designing appropriate algorithms to solve these problems will be the important task here. Because disk IO is expensive, so we should try to minimize the disk IO. So that is why developing efficient algorithms is important here. So even if there are any slight improvement in the demand paging methods, that is going to gain a large system performance. There are many different page replacement algorithms. So every operating system probably has its own replacement algorithm, but we should know which particular replacement algorithm is good. So how do we select a particular replacement algorithm? So again, it depends on that. We should have an algorithm that is which is going to result in the lowest page fault rate. Which will give us the lowest page fault rate will be the best page replacement algorithm. Now we should know which algorithm will give us the lowest page fault rate. Then how do we evaluate it? So this will be evaluated by running an algorithm on a particular string of memory references and then compute the number of page faults. So we will be running these algorithms on a particular string of memory references. We are going to run these algorithms on some memory references, and then we are going to compute the number of page faults that each algorithm is giving. So here the string of memory references is called a reference string. So we can generate reference strings artificially, that is by using a random number generator, for example, or else we can trace a given system and record the address of each memory reference. But if we use the second method, it is going to result in a large number of data. It will give us a choice between the large number of data. To reduce the number of data, again we should use two facts. That is, one is for a given page size, here the page size will be generally fixed by the hardware or system. We need to consider only the page number rather than the entire address. Since we are using the second method, that is, we can generate the reference addresses, that is by tracing a given system and record the address of each memory reference. What we are going to do is, for given page size, that is which is set by the hardware or system, we need to consider only the page number rather than the entire address. That is first thing. Second, if we have a reference to page P, and then any immediately following references to page P will never cause a page fault. If we have an address reference to page P, so the next references that are making to that particular same page is not going to have a page fault, because at the first time only it is going to be referenced. This reference string, it is just a page number, not the full address. This reference string consists of the page numbers only, not the complete address. next, if repeated access to the same page does not cause a page fault, okay, only at the first time it might cause a page fault, but when as and when that particular page is been re-accessed, that time it is not going to cause a page fault. The results of this, it depends on the number of frames available, okay. So the amount of the list whatever we are getting, it is going to depend on the number of frames available in the, for example, if we trace a particular process, we might record the following address sequence. You can see these are the following address sequences, okay. So from these sequence of addresses, taking 100 bytes per page, this sequence can be reduced to the following string. The first address is 0100. If I take 100 bytes for one page, I can take it as 1. Next is 0432, I can take it as 4. Next is 0101, I can take it as 1. Next we have 0612, I can take it as 6. Okay, that is with 100 bytes per page. So 6 I can take. Next is 0102, I can take it as 1. Next is, you can see it is 0103, 0104. These are all on the within those 100 bytes only. So I'm not going to consider all of this. Next is again 0610. So next 6 I'm taking. Next I have 0102. So that 1 is taken. Next we have 0103, 0104, 0101. So these all comes under those 100 bytes itself. So I'm not going to take. Next 6 I'm taking. That is 0610. From that I'm 6 taking. Next is again 0102. 1 is taken. 0103, 0104, 0101, up till here I'm not going to consider, only once I'm considering it, because all those fall under the same 100 bytes. Next I'm going to consider 0609. Next I'm going to consider 0102, that is 1. Again the last address, that is 0105, will fall under those 100 bytes itself, so I'm not going to consider it. So these, from these address sequence, I can refer to these page numbers. Okay, considering 100 bytes per page, that means each page will have 100 bytes. I can consider only these page numbers. To determine the number of page faults for a particular reference string and page replacement algorithm, we should know the number of page frames available. Okay, in order to find out the number of page faults for particular reference string and particular page replacement algorithm, we should know the number of page frames available. Okay, as the number of frames available increases, the number of page faults goes on decreasing. Okay, we can see in this graph, we will expect such a curve, that is, as the number of frames increasing, we can see that the number of page faults drops to some minimal level. Okay, so by adding extra memory, extra physical memory, we can increase the number of frames. Okay, if we increase the number of frames, the number of page faults is going to decrease.